Here's the set piece, and that finds the back of the net on the rebound. Perea, 94th minute. Orlando City might just get the 3 points that they need to punch their ticket in the playoffs. Are we checking it for who actually gets the goal, Pato or Perea? Are we looking for offside? What exactly is Alan Chapman looking for here?
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the Orlando Soccer Show, where today I'm going to spend another hour and a half complaining. Yeah, doesn't that sound fun? This is we're recording this one day after the infamous decision from head referee Alan Chapman, and we're going to talk about it. We're also going to talk about the Orlando Pride season being over. We're going to talk about some news that's happening in the rest of MLS and NWSL. And, of course, we're going to do our weird news and red cards. First off, hey, I'm back. It's been a couple weeks, almost a month since I was on a show. I think the last time was October 5th was the last time I actually did a show with you guys, because I've been calling games for NWSL and USL League One and Championships. So that season's now over. They're heading into the playoffs. So here I am, back with you guys. And I guess thankfully or unfortunately, I haven't been able to watch any of the games live because of what I've been doing. Like, I saw the Pride game on Friday, the last game of the season, was the last game that I was able to go to. But everything before that, I was out of town calling games. So, good thing, bad thing, I don't know.
It's for the best, probably.
And then yesterday, I missed out on the entertaining thing that happened at Exploria Stadium. I guess it would be entertaining. It got a lot of people talking, that's for sure.
Yeah.
But hey, let's talk about it. First off, welcome in, everyone. Welcome to Gavin Ewbank and Brad Newton. I'm Austin David. And now that we got that out of the way, wow, what a week it has been.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yesterday was obviously Halloween too, and I didn't really do like a costume because I was working. So I just wore my Orlando City jersey, and I joked that I was just a depressed person for Halloween. I tweeted, "I am someone constantly going through the five stages of grief," and that could not have been more on point for where we were after yesterday, because after that goal was called off, I was in denial. I got angry. I started bargaining with myself that things could be different, and now I'm just in depression mode. I haven't gotten to acceptance. We'll see if we get there. Not great.
It's funny you mention that, because yesterday I actually went as Coach Beard from Ted Lasso, but I was dressed in, I didn't have like a Richmond AFC like training gear, so I just wore like the Orlando City training gear that I had from when I worked there. And I basically went on the Odyssey that Coach Beard went on, and that basically the one episode that just followed him after their FA Cup loss. So, we're all going through it over here. I actually did tell Thierry Henry to shut up.
Hey, listen, we're just glad that you've made it here alive.
Hey, every day is a gift.
Every day is a gift. Well, for those who have been potentially living under a rock or have not been following along with what has been happening in the last 48 hours or so, Orlando played Nashville at home, final game of the regular season at home for Orlando, with a chance to clinch playoff berth and potentially a home playoff game if they won. Daryl Dike scored in the 18th minute. They were up 1-0 going into the halftime break. And then, just as Orlando has done the last couple of games, they start out the second half flat, concede a turnover, and Hani Mukhtar scores in the 53rd. Now, I don't know what's going on with Orlando and why their starts to second halves have been just absolutely atrocious as of late, but it is a concerning trend that nobody seems to have an answer for. And I've asked a multitude of people, and I'm like, what's up, guys? Like, why do you keep starting second halves badly? And everybody who I've asked, from Tesho to Nani to Oscar, they're just like, well, we don't know. It could be a number of different things, but we do not know. But it's a trend that has been going on you go back to the, well, the Columbus game was a bit of a misnomer because they were already down 2-0. But you go back to the New England game, that was a later portion of the second half. The Montreal game, they concede in the 51st minute. The Cincinnati game, they won, so that doesn't count. The DC United game, they scored in the 6th minute. Nashville, last time they played them, conceded in the 59th minute and had to pull back from, at that point, 2-0 down to tie it at 2-2. Going back to the Philadelphia game, they conceded in the 61st minute. The other Montreal game, they conceded 2 very late, so that doesn't count either. So maybe not as much of a trend as I originally thought. But it is still concerning, because like, it's not necessarily the goals that have been scored, because all the players have talked about how they've started the second half flat in games as of late. So it's not necessarily the score lines that have been reflective of that, but it is a trend nonetheless that has been continuing.
I would say, so. I mean, it makes you kind of wonder, just throughout this season, I think one of the things that made Orlando so good last year is that you could see from beginning to end of the matches, especially beginning in games last year, there was so much intensity from the team. And they scored a lot of early goals last year, a lot of first half goals. But just for whatever reason this year, kind of throughout the season, things have not always, but it just kind of feels more flat. I mean, obviously the team is struggling up front. It's struggling to create those chances, and maybe that's part of it. It's they're just kind of out there with no real, conviction that they had last year. Even early in the year when they were playing kind of well to start off the first couple of months. But it's definitely concerning. I mean, especially as you kind of, like, this is the final games. Like, this is the time that you should be hungry to go out there, especially at home in a game that you, like you said, is must win to get into the playoffs. There should be more to that, and that should be able to kind of overcome just any tactical deficiencies that may be out there. The one thing that you can control is the intensity and the energy that you put into the game. And like you said, it wasn't necessarily there, and heading into the playoffs, you know, knock on wood that they do get there, is something that's going to have to be, you know, very keeping a close eye on when we get there.
Absolutely. And I think the biggest thing for this season is comparatively to last year, and I think I've mentioned this on the show a couple times, Oscar was very adamant about calling his team protagonists in 2020, mm-hmm. where they were the ones controlling the games. This year, he hasn't used that word very much in press conferences. He hasn't really, and it hasn't really been on the field. They haven't necessarily been protagonists of games a lot this year. And I think that's why you see the drop in form, the drop in intensity, and the drop in results is just simply because they are not the controllers of the game as much as they were last year, because I think teams have kind of realized what they do and what they are capable of and how they play. And the way Orlando's defense is specifically, they're very robotic when it comes to what they are asked to do. There's not necessarily a lot of creativity being asked of them. It's just be defenders and defend. Kind of with that comes, I don't want to say complacency, but it certainly seems like it's just kind of going through the motions in some points for the team.
I mean, I'm curious because I obviously, since I've moved, I haven't been able to watch every minute of the team like I was able to last year. And those things do stick out in the differences. But I'm kind of curious, do you think that it's something more, like, do you get a sense? Like, this is the same group. It's the same players with the same coaches and staff and everything. So, mm-hmm. yeah, you know, I get, it's understandable that same level of intensity and whatnot is not going to necessarily be there as it was, because last year was obviously new, and last year was, you know, a brand new thing that everyone's buying into, and there's that excitement around it. Mm-hmm. Do you get the sense that it's by design that the team is not necessarily as pragmatic, or does Oscar kind of see something that maybe they're just not capable of doing that anymore?
I don't know. I mean, like, from the times I've been at training to the times that I've seen or talked to them, it still has a very similar vibe. Like, the trainings are upbeat and everyone's happy and excited. I genuinely have, like, just like what they have told me, nobody knows what has changed. Mm-hmm. Or at least they're not telling us what has changed. It could be very, you know, something that's happening behind the scenes that just nobody knows about, which tends to happen in professional sports. You often find things out later, or you never find out things at all and you jump to conclusions. You know, that tends to happen a lot in sports, jumping to conclusions. But with this team, there are no easy answers to why things have not gone their way. You know, their last couple results, they've drawn three of their last four. And it just so happens that those three draws are against teams that they needed to beat. And they could not.
Yeah, I mean, it's... You expect that the result... You're not going to see the exact same team every day. And, I mean, we see it with the best teams, especially, like, in a league like Major League Soccer, where parity is such a big thing. And good teams have good runs, and, you know, they also have bad runs. And I think it's... That what we saw last year to a degree, I mean, when we all kind of saw that this team was overachieving on expectations, it's not necessarily a shock when really they didn't add anything. They didn't add anything, you know, any big pieces, that there was regression on that from last year, because we did see a lot that they were outperforming their XGs and everything. They were, you know, they were scoring more. They were defending better than what the numbers suggested that they should have been. But it's definitely a lot of that, I think, was just due to the fact that the team itself, the way that they carried themselves on the field, was definitely to a higher level than we've seen. And it just feels like they've kind of regressed on that part. And that has made everything else just flatten back out to where we actually expected them to be last year to what we're seeing.
You know, I now that I'm starting to think about it more, and trying to think about, like, the progression of the way the season has gone compared to last year. Last year, most of the team was healthy.
Right. Yeah, and that's a big thing, too, is health and
I can't think of a time where Orlando City's health was bad last year. This year, you've been missing Sebas Mendez for most of the season. I mean, heck, we talked about how important Sebas has been. The results dropped off as soon as he got hurt.
And I think the biggest long-term loss they had last year was just Jao. I mean, like, did Nani suffer anything serious? I think Pereira
was out for a bit, right? Right, and when Jao was healthy, they were playing good. And then when he was hurt, the whole flow of the team got messed up, and they started dropping results. You know, not big results, but they started dropping results they probably should have had otherwise. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't necessarily something like defensively. It was just the whole team got kind of shifted about a little bit. And again, consistency is so key when it comes to playing. And I've talked to coaches from every level, from high school to college to professional. And it's always interesting to pick their brains because they always have something different to say. But one consistent thing is they like to have consistency. And when you don't have consistency and you have different voices, the innate things that you would do without thinking become different when a different voice is telling you to do something. So if that makes any sense, when you have a coach or a player in the back line saying step up, and then you hear that voice in one way, like, sometimes inherently you'll just do it because you just know that's how the player wants to play. Like, he'll have your back while you step up or something. But if another player comes in and he plays a different style and he plays a completely different way of you know, defending, it throws your whole game off, and you have to start thinking more rather than just playing and being out there.
You know, you mentioned what's different and what's changed, and they're just, I've been looking at it statistically, and early on there's a narrative that Chris Mueller hasn't been playing as well as he was in last year, and I think it's pretty visible that he hasn't been. But if you look at it statistically, he has 6 assists on the year, and he had 6 assists in 2020. The biggest difference is his drop off in goal production, which has really been the biggest thing. He had 10 goals last year, and he's only had 3 so far this year. So thinking about what's been different there, Risa Pereira, if we're also looking at it, I think he hasn't been playing as well. But then again, when you look at the statistics, in 2020 he had 5 assists and 3 goals, and this year he has 1 goal and 7 assists. So it's kind of a push, I think, if we're looking at it that way.
What was that I brought up the other day? Orlando is like 6th in the league in goals and assists created from their 2 DPs, despite the fact that we all kind of assume that the team's not scoring.
Yes. That was a very interesting statistic that you brought up. And it's so as of right now, 8th are Nani and Pereira. Now that's between 2 players. Right? The only other duo that is goals and assists combined by MLSDPs is Sporting Kansas City's Pulido and Russell, who have 32 goals and assists combined. Every other team has 3 designated players that is combined, and yet somehow Orlando is right up there with the Columbuses and the Seattles, who are just a couple ahead of them, with guys like Ladero and Rui Diaz and Joao Paulo.
I think it does.
So that says something.
I think it does speak to the seasons that Nani and Pereira are having. I think visibly, I mean, it just looks like something is off. Like it's the sniff test, you know. It doesn't look like it's gelling as it was in years prior.
But you know what it is, right? It's they're getting older.
Well, yeah, but that's the thing is Nani. This year has outperformed Nani from last year.
Yeah, but Nani, it's hard to compare Nani last year to Nani this year because it was such a shortened season last year.
He played 3 fewer. I mean, he's so far this year he's played 3 fewer matches. But I mean, looking at the numbers, 10 goals versus 9 last year, 7 assists versus 5 last year. It's
oh yeah. Well, he started out the season incredibly well. Uh-huh. But again, just like Matt Doyle has said, and everyone has given him shit for this, but he was right. Second half Nani, not as good as first half Nani.
Second half Nani has 1 goal and 1 assist since August 22nd.
Yeah.
Is that something that Orlando City should consider?
Absolutely.
When his contract is up at the end of the year?
I mean, he's 34 years old. I mean, you do take it into consideration, but he's still your team's best offensive weapon, as weird as that sounds.
I mean, here's what, like, because obviously we know that the Wilfs want to be they want to be involved, and they want to put in the investment in Orlando City, so
they want to spend money on big players,
right? And that's where, like, I'm really fascinated to know what their philosophy, if they have one, or if that's more giving Muzy and those guys a directive, like, hey, you know, we're going to give you the money to go out and get these players. You tell us what you want, and we'll try to make that happen. Because, you know, like you said, he's getting older, and he's, you know, when DP spots are so crucial, do we want to spend that money on a guy who might be productive, but could be better used on a player that's going to be able, that we can count on for all 34 games?
Well, think about it this way. If you look at Mauricio Pereira, he's 31 years old. He'll be 32 at the beginning of next year. Right? He's still younger than Nani is, and he's still a very good player. His contract is up at the end of the season, and so there's going to be a question of, do they re-sign him and maybe try and buy him down a little bit? Or do they have to use another designated player contract on him? Same thing with Nani. Like, Nani, by far, is a designated player, I would say. But if they try and just sign him for a one-year deal, they could get him as a TAM signing. And maybe open up all 3 designated player slots to bring in some much-needed depth at different positions. There's also the question of what happens with Daryl Dike at the end of the year. Because it really is a matter of when, not if, he gets sold to Europe, I think, at this point. The biggest thing with the previous regime of Orlando City, like with Alex Leitao, he didn't want to sell Daryl Dike. This new ownership, well, they might. And he wants to go overseas. He wants to go try himself in bigger leagues.
Yeah, and right. I mean, I wouldn't be opposed to it if that's ultimately where he wants to go. But I think if we're looking at it under the lens of being in a new regime, they're not hurting for money. They've got NFL money. Like, this isn't...
Right, no, but I'm saying they could go buy somebody else and sell DK because he wants to go overseas.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if they may not be asking for as much... I think they're going to take it regardless.
Right, they may not be asking for as much as the previous group was, though.
And the thing about Nani is he's on almost $2.5 million right now. I don't know that he's going to take enough of a pay cut to get close to Tamron.
If it's only a one-year deal, because he's currently on a three-year deal.
I mean, maybe, but that's, again, like, he's given up a lot of money where he's already kind of stated, too, that he does want to go back to Portugal, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if that option's on the table, it's I can take a lot less money to play here, or I can go finish out my career here. I mean, that's obviously more of a personal, you know, something that we can only speculate on at this point. But I don't see him taking that big of a pay cut.
Mm. Yeah, if I were him, I probably wouldn't either. Just based on why, like, yeah,
it depends on who offers you more.
Yeah, if I only have like a year or two left, you're absolutely right there. I think if you sort of field what options are available to you, but I mean, if it's not worth it to come back for him, I wouldn't blame him if he didn't.
Yeah. And again, we can talk about what will happen at the end of the season when the end of the season happens. There's still one more game to go, guys. I just want to reiterate that fact because there is the game against Montreal, which is... It's pretty much a must-win. It's not 100% a must-win, depending on the result that happens on Wednesday with Montreal and Houston. But all things considered, Orlando has to win. And there is still a chance for them to host a playoff game. It's a very outside chance, but there is a chance.
Yeah.
Depending on the results of Red Bulls Atlanta, Philly NYC, and Red Bulls Nashville. If those three... games happen in favor of Orlando, which is Red Bulls beating Atlanta, Philly beating New York City, and then Red Bulls on Sunday drawing or losing Nashville, then that's a possibility that Orlando can host a playoff game if they beat Montreal.
Right. Well, New York and Atlanta both have a game in hand, so they have 6 points each.
Right. They play each other on Wednesday, is what I'm saying.
They do play each other. And... Atlanta's
Red
one
Bulls
back.
Need to beat Atlanta.
Red Bulls are
that.
Two back.
Yeah. Red Bulls basically would need to beat Atlanta.
Yeah.
And if Montreal loses, then there is no other team that can catch Orlando, who currently are on 48 points.
Mm-hmm. Right. So Montreal hosting Houston, a Houston team that has not won a single road game this year against Montreal, that are 8-3-4 at home. If Montreal does not win that game, Orlando City is locked into the playoffs, and then Sunday becomes all about positioning. If Orlando is to not get into that spot where they can host a playoff game, your three options are Philadelphia, Nashville, and New York City. Philadelphia, second place, 11-3-3 at home. Nashville has not lost a single home game this year, and then New York City, 10-3-3 at home. And as we all know, Orlando got their asses kicked 5-0 earlier in the year. So
there is also a very outside chance that Atlanta or New York could host a playoff game, depending on what happens in the final matches of the season. So if New York wins their final two, then they'd be on 52 points. And if New York City loses their final game, then New York Red Bulls would jump New York City. And it could potentially be a New York derby in Harrison, New Jersey. That's interesting.
I would also think that if Orlando, well, they can't. Yeah, they could pass New York City. If Orlando was to pass New York City, mm-hmm. and Atlanta somehow jumps up there, and we get an Orlando-Atlanta game in the first round.
That's distinctly possible.
Yeah.
There's a lot to happen here, but the point of the matter is Orlando needs to get a result. And at the very least, they need to draw, but they need to win in order to try and have a chance, an outside chance of hosting a game.
Which we never fully ran down how we got to this point of Orlando still needing a win to clinch the playoffs, Austin.
Yeah, we haven't. God, we've spent like 20-something minutes talking about everything else but the play-in question.
Take us down memory lane. What happened in the 94th minute of that game last night?
So Pato, remember you him? Guys, yeah. Remember that guy? He came into the game, and Orlando had a free kick right at the end of the game.
It's a great kick.
Pato strikes it. Joe Willis tips it onto the bar, comes off his back, doesn't go in. Daryl Dike crashes the box, kind of gets a touch on it, as well as a touch on Alistair Johnson. The ball goes to Andres Perea. He knocks it in. Orlando's up 2-1. Crowd goes wild. And then the funniest thing happened. It went to VAR. And Alan Chapman, who is not got a good history of reffing Orlando City games, because he's the guy who reffed the Orlando-New York City playoff game last year, and he was suspended for the rest of the playoffs for getting it wrong. He comes into this game and gets a chance to decide the result for, or shall I say, against Orlando, and does so by calling a foul on Daryl Dike in that buildup. So the goal's wiped out. Orlando draw 1-1. Oscar's upset. The whole team's upset. And that's where we are.
Yeah, yep. You know, it's just kind of... Another thing that happened, ironically, earlier in the day is obviously Bill does not really care that much for soccer. And I was telling her about the game that was going to be on. This was earlier in the day before the game had started. And I was like, yeah, they play. They need to get into the playoffs. But there is this referee who is very not good and usually screws things up for Orlando City. And she was like, well, that doesn't seem right. Like, why would they allow him to be in their games? I was like, well... That's the thing, is just they don't care. And sure enough, things fall that way. And he takes the goal off the board. So it's, I don't know. It's one of those things where obviously this is not the only team that injustices like this happen to in Major League Soccer. Orlando City is not the only team that has been wronged by the referees. But it is just astonishing how over the years, and it's just not like little calls, like 50-50 balls, 50-50 calls that go either way. It's just so many egregious, blatant things happening that go against Orlando City that every single person that was not on the field can agree on being wrong. And in this case, it's something that no one is clear. Like,
it wasn't clear and obvious to overturn.
Right, and that's the thing, too, is we've all aired our grievances about how VAR is used in this league. But in this, like, you have the video to look at. And if the referees were not looking at the same video that we were looking at that was shown to us, I mean, they obviously don't have, most likely, the camera that was sitting right there that an Orlando City comms person was using to capture that play. But if you don't have that angle, then you don't have the best angle. So you're making a call on, like you said, something that's not clear and obvious. And it's just, it's pathetic. And it is a cancer to this league that these referees go out here day after day. And it's somewhere every single week they do something that is just so bad. And it is tarnishing the competitive integrity of Major League Soccer. Like, if Orlando City, you know, we just sat here and talked about how we think they're going to make the playoffs because they're in the position and they hold all control. But there's also a pretty realistic possibility that Montreal wins the next two games. New York and Atlanta could jump them, and Orlando does not make the playoffs. And if they don't make the playoffs because of that decision, I wouldn't blame a single person for not continuing to have faith in this league and thinking that any of this is legit. It's just pathetic. I mean, what is this? Evan Weston, friend Evan Weston here, put on his timeline today. He dug up a tweet from, what was it, 2019.
Oh, the Zlatan quote. Tweet.
Yeah, a quote from Zlatan Ibrahimovic about referee Alan Chapman. Here, let's see. Got it loading now. Going in on him here. This was a game, obviously Zlatan was when he was with the Galaxy. This from 2019, August 26th. He needs to go back to the drawing board and learn basic, because the way he talks, the way he acts, the way he does his things, there's no connecting him to the game. He felt the fans came here for him tonight, so he made it a game for himself. A game like that cannot be decided by the referee. The teams needed to decide the game. This referee, I remember him from Portland when he said something stupid to me. Today, he said something stupid to me. He needs to go back. I don't know. He needs to go back to the guy in charge and do the most basic stuff. This, to me, if I'm being honest. I get fouled. A guy says nothing. A little push. Quote. I guess he's quoting from Chapman. After that, it influences my game. I can't play free. I cannot play 100% because every time I touch somebody, it's like I'm sending them to the cemetery. So also ending that off with a little bit of Zlatan flavor.
Oh, brother, this guy stinks!
And then on top of that, obviously, like you said, Austin, this is the same guy that completely miffed the situation last year in the playoffs, going into penalty kicks and lost all control, had to be suspended for that. And he's still considered one of the best referees in Major League Soccer. He's still a guy that gets prime appointments every year. I don't know how you defend that if you're Major League Soccer and if you're the Pro Referee Association or organization.
Because they don't it's inexcusable. Have any better ones.
They don't, and that's like, I don't know. I don't know what can be done. I don't know if anyone knows what can be done, because this is just, it's laughable.
It's human error.
That, like, any of this is
at the end of the day
legitimate.
At the end of the day, this foul that was called is a judgment decision by the referee. He gave the goal, and the VAR official at the time told Allen to go take a look at it.
Well, I'm not indifferent to making a split second decision. We all see things in the moment, and you miss stuff and you see stuff that maybe you saw, but you misinterpreted what happened. But when you do go, you know, I have no problem with, hey, you know, something might have happened there. Come take a look at this and see for yourself. But if you do that, and you still find something that didn't even happen, you have the opportunity to watch that replay as many times as you need to make that call, to have all the information laid out in front of you, and you still get it wrong. There is
right,
no
okay,
excuse
so
for that.
There
and
is,
to your, and to your point, Austin, he initially called it a goal. It's not
right.
Until after he goes back to VAR. So what there was so
right.
Clear and obvious that he's able to overturn that goal and
change
that's, the decision.
And that's the argument, is that it wasn't clear and obvious. Now, from the angles that we saw after the fact compared to the ones that were available to them on the field, some things change depending on your perception of what happened. Like the behind the goal angle that Orlando City tweeted out, that is a much more clear and obvious video angle compared to the ones that are from behind the play.
But if that's the case, I don't understand how he makes that decision to change it. If he doesn't have a video that is that clear as Orlando City's, how do you change that decision when you
right.
don't
and
know?
I think that's the biggest thing, is that the clear and obvious rule needs to be reinforced by the Pro Referees Organization, because there's, I feel like across the league, there's just been too many calls that haven't been clear and obvious. And that's something that I've seen from Taylor Twellman, from God, everybody that has,
because it's
has
not just an MLS problem. We see this happen in England all the time too, with the way
of
that
course.
VAR used
yeah, yeah.
over there. When they're and, calling offsides by the fractionist of margins, like, what is clear and obvious about the, you know, the integrity of that play that that this is what the game has evolved into. Like, it's not...
Right. Well,
the point
again,
was to make the right calls, and when you're not making the right calls, then what are we doing here? What is the point of it?
No, I understand that, but sometimes the right calls, like, it is based on your perception of the right call as well, because if they're off by a shoelace, then they're still off. Like, by the definition of the rule, they are offside. So it's about the perception of the rule based on the individual referee. And it's also based because the way England does it is that it's all digital. You know, they're not going by the eye tests. They're going by the actual, like, digital lines that are made. So it's a bit different comparatively when it comes to offside. But the one thing you have to remember is the way games are called by referees, it is based on their perception of how the game is going. So if there is a game that is incredibly physical and they're letting them play on, it's going to be a very, very physical game. And that's the way the referee is going to let it happen. Now, if the referee steps in and starts calling every single foul, the game will change based on the way the referee calls the game.
Which is ironic, because that's also not how Alan Chapman was calling the game yesterday.
Right. But again,
in that second half, he handed out like four yellow cards.
Right. But that's the thing. It's based, they set the tempo of the game, the referees, whether you like it or not. And there is no... Can anyone come up with a better alternative right now?
I mean, aside from...
The better alternative here's the thing is we're talking about... It's not like this was a call that was made moment. Like you said, the call was to allow the goal to stand. You know, the issue here is that this is not necessarily, it's not even an in the moment thing anymore, because he comes off the field to look at this play in close detail and then still gets the call wrong. Whether or not you perceive you're giving an explanation to something that did not happen. You know, the explanation is that Daryl DK fouled the defender, when that is simply not true. And
is it though?
Is deniable to anybody who watched it.
So the explanation given was that DK denied Johnston the ability to clear. But when you watch it, Johnston's leg is extended into DK's like ankle and shin as he's taking a shot. DK's ahead of him. You could see it in the video that Orlando City have on that they posted.
Yeah, but that's the one they posted, not the one that the referee saw.
But again, if it's not clear and obvious what's happening there, why are you changing that decision?
Right. And that goes back to the argument of clear and obvious. And
different angles breed different perspectives in the way that these cameras are shooting the game. But at the same time, what angle were they looking at that would have completely altered the way that play turned out?
It looks different from behind than it looks from in front. I will say that. But again, to not to spend too much time on this, because we do have other stuff to talk about. I know this is like the big thing to talk about, but I feel like it's been running to the ground at this point. There's nothing you can do about it now. The definition of clear and obvious needs to change, or the referees need to be educated on what actually means clear and obvious. Because right now, there's too much of a gray area for there to be one way or the other. I think we'll leave it at that.
And right now, you've got a referee who 2 years in a row has been directly involved in massive failures of understanding the rules and the jobs of his, you know, of the game.
I don't know. I don't think this is
for Orlando City.
Gavin, this is not a misunderstanding of the rule. This is a judgment call. This is a judgment call that he made that it was a foul. It's not a misunderstanding of the rule like it was last year.
I mean, it's a misunderstanding of what constitutes a foul on a player that was not fouling another player.
But that's a judgment call.
It's a misunderstanding
of say it.
It's a misunderstanding of physics and how a body moves across someone else.
Yeah.
Right, but in the grand scheme of things, it's not a misunderstanding of the rule like it was last year. It's just a judgment call made by the official.
There are rules in physics, so it is a misunderstanding of the rule.
You're not wrong. You're not wrong. All right. We'll move on from Orlando City. But before we move on from Orlando City, I want to talk about one last thing.
Psych.
The attendance for the final game of the regular season in Orlando. Very much left to be desired. I would say that's probably the best way of describing the official attendance, which was announced at 15,959.
Yikes on bikes.
Yeah. So this year has been weird because of COVID and everything, obviously. Mm-hmm. But
it's also Halloween.
Orlando City. Yeah. I mean, Orlando City has averaged 15,000 fans per game this year in 15 games played. They are less than 2019, which was 22,000.
Yeah.
Now they are still just below top 10 in MLS attendance. They're below Columbus Crew, who averaged 16,000 fans, and just above Real Salt Lake, who allows 15,028 fans average. So they're ahead of teams like LA Galaxy, Minnesota, FC Dallas, New York Red Bulls, Philly, DC, Houston, Colorado, who's actually a very good team this year, Vancouver, Chicago, Toronto, NYCFC, and Montreal. Funny enough, NYCFC is actually the second worst team in attendance this year. That's also because of COVID regulations and restrictions that they've had in place, but also they play in a baseball stadium.
No one wants to watch a soccer game at Yankee Stadium.
Yeah.
As great as Yankee Stadium is to watch a baseball game at, not the best.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, yeah, I mean, it's weird. Obviously, Florida has been open as long as anybody's been open since the pandemic kind of hit.
Mm-hmm.
I think you would have expected larger crowds by now. I mean, especially, it's not the best team in the league, and it's not even a team that was as good as they were last year, but it's a...
by points definition, they are the best team in Orlando City history. Thank you very much.
Although I will say, too, as far as what you're paying to see home performances, this has been the best that Orlando City has ever played across a full 34 game home schedule. So there mm-hmm. is that. Fans are getting their money's worth. Orlando's only lost two times at home. They've never had a good record at home, a record this good at home. Yep. So your money's you're getting more for your money when you show up. That's for sure. We're in October. Vaccines have been out for, a while now, and they've been accessible to everybody, everybody minus children for a while now. So maybe that has something to do. People love to bring their kids to games, and that's kind of a big driver is families coming to these games. Maybe a lot of people are still a little bit worried about that. You know, we've only just now getting vaccines approved for children, so maybe that'll have a big effect on the games come next year. But, I mean, other than that, what more could you want? It's a team that is winning games. They're certainly not losing games at home. And they've got a chance, they're on track to make the playoffs for the second year in a row, and they've got a fighter's chance to win an MLS Cup. So, it's if there was a year to go out there and be supportive, this would be it. And for some reason, the numbers just haven't caught up. I mean, we're seeing in other places around the country, it hasn't been a big deal. But
Brad, I want to get your thoughts on this. What do you think is, besides the whole stuff that Gavin mentioned, what do you think is kind of hindering Orlando City? Not just the city, but when we talk about the pride as well.
That's a whole.
They still have some of the best players in the league, and their results at home are unfortunately not good. But
It's twofold. One, obviously the pandemic continuing to, be a thing, and people not really being fully comfortable going out in the crowds. Like, that's pretty big.
Especially with as bad as Delta got this summer in Florida.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, you can look at all the sports in Orlando, and you can see you can make the same argument for pretty much all of them. Really, I mean, UCF football doesn't have the same sort of attendance as it did, compared to 2 years ago. The Magic certainly have not had the same sort of crowds come out for their games. It's a real world logistical problem that a lot of teams are still facing, and it's an ongoing issue. Past that, I mean, I think the club has kind of like squandered a lot of good faith that people in the market had about the team. Like, the excitement that was originally around the shiny new thing has worn off here. They haven't been performing as well as people would like, and so it's going to take, you know, some effort on this new ownership group to really sort of make it seem attractive again. I mean, maybe depending on how this upcoming transfer window looks and who they bring in and how this team finishes the season, if they make the playoffs and make a run, maybe there's some excitement built around there. But from a marketing and positioning standpoint, I mean, one of the things that I think troubles a lot of MLS clubs, you know, you said they're outside the top 10 in attendance, but I think one of the things league-wide is, you know, when it comes to like media rights and how the league is presented to, you know, people at home, if you don't know where to watch games when you're at home, it's going to make it really difficult for you to want to come out and go to a game when you just don't have that kind of attachment to them when they're not home. So
yeah, especially when so many people have cut the cord nowadays. So even when they are playing on Fox and ESPN and Unimas, people don't have the access to watch that, because then it's also blocked out. You know, when it's on national TV, it's not on local TV. It's not on ESPN Plus. Or, you know, when it is ESPN Plus, you still need a cable sign-in to log in. But, I mean, the other option around that is watching on LionNation.com, which watching on the computer, you know, if I have to do it, I'll do it, but it's also not enjoyable. I don't like sitting in my chair for you know, 2 hours straight and having to look at a small screen and watch. And
yeah, and the site has been kind of buggy as well. Like, it hasn't worked properly from the times that I've used it. There are times where I can't cast from my computer to my TV because it just doesn't work. There are times when the video just doesn't load properly. And, you know, I get it. First year trying to figure things out. But also, you don't have any other options. Like, some teams just broadcast on their website for free, but it actually, like, works well. The one thing I hate about Lion Nation is it doesn't allow you to fast forward or rewind or you know, anything like that. You just press play and that's it. Whereas if I was watching on YouTube TV a couple years ago, pause, rewind, DVR, watch it back, etc.
I definitely think a lot about like what the Wilfs have here, and they know what they have, and they know what the potential is here, and it's going to be very interesting to see what happens over the next 6 months leading into those first games next year. You know, obviously, you know, like Brad said, it's not Orlando City's not the shiny new toy in town anymore. They've you know, cooled down a little bit in terms of popularity and excitement. But I think back a lot to those early years, you know, when everything was so much centered around, you know, filling the bowl, and Orlando was constantly around the community. And again, like, COVID obviously has a lot to do with the ability to do stuff like that right now. But I mean, even just simple things like when they were giving out magnets to everyone and everyone had a magnet on their car and you couldn't drive anywhere around Orlando without seeing that logo somewhere every 5 minutes. And, you know, the first couple years when the Pride were there, they did on the eve of like the season every year, like scarves around the city, and they would just leave Pride scarves all over town. Like, I feel like things like that, just simple stuff, you know, driving down I-4, there's always at least one or two Orlando City billboards up. And, you know, after the first few years, I stopped seeing that stuff. You stopped seeing the magnets and the billboards and all these things, and it tunes down the awareness, especially in a place like Orlando where there are a lot of new people constantly coming into the community. So maybe they're not aware that the team is even there.
There's also the fact that they just haven't been good up until last year.
Yeah. And that definitely obviously plays a big role, you know, in it. People
over under. Do you think more people attend the last Magic home game of the season than City game of the season?
How many people have been attending Magic games this season?
Are bad. So
yeah, well, they are bad. But they've also they've done okay when it comes to attendance. They've only had two home games, but they're averaging about 16,000, which is more than Orlando City.
I mean, but if they continue to be bad,
yeah,
like, are people still gonna show up for that?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it depends, because here's the thing. As bad as the Magic are, if they're playing, say, the Heat or the Raptors or the Sixers, those fans will show up for those games. And I mean, because of Orlando being such a, I guess, transient city, is that the right word?
Yeah.
So, like, I mean, people just come and go. Like, people will just come here for a weekend and vacation for Disney and go to a Sixers game or a Bulls game or a Warriors game, even.
I see what you're saying. Let's say this. March 26th, that they would have one, two, three. They'd have four home games after March 26th, and it's against the Sacramento Kings.
I mean, Orlando tries to do that. I mean, they have a booth at the Orlando International. I mean, they had the City Pub there too, right? I don't believe that's there any longer, though.
At the airport, it's still there.
It's still there.
Oh, okay. Okay.
The one downtown in Orlando was closed due to health concerns.
Right. Right. The last time I was at the airport, it was closed, probably because this was in like August of last year, obviously still in the middle of the pandemic.
That would be why.
But I mean, yeah, I mean, that is still something that they shoot for, obviously, you know, with a lot of a big Brazilian population, and the team was owned and run by Brazilians for a while, and then certainly in the way that the stars that they brought in. I wonder, has that ever been asked of the Wilfs, if they take that, if they understand that, and that plays into what they want with this club?
I haven't had a chance to talk to any of the Wilfs yet, because I've been out and about and haven't been to any of the events other than their unveiling, but all the media was there. So I'm hoping to do something in the off season with them, but it's very up in the air right now. So eventually I will have a chance to talk with one of them to get some questions. I think they'll probably do something before the season starts. But right now it's just kind of who knows what. So.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of potential there. I am very curious and also excited to see what the Wilfs can do. I mean,
again, it's only been a couple months since they've taken over. Give them an off season and see what they can do. But there's hopefully a good future for Orlando City to come. And
maybe I'm being too optimistic, but they bought this as an investment play, and to get the biggest investment, to get the most out of it, They're gonna want to grow the brand, and they're gonna want to put a lot of money in that to make that happen. So we'll see.
Yep.
And that involves getting people to the game. So I'm sure they've got some plans for how to do that.
Yeah, they're also, from what I've heard, they're doing a lot more with the academies and with the, you know, the younger kids, as well as the B team for Orlando City, which will potentially be playing.
I do believe Mark Wilf, the chairman, did an interview. But where he said that was going to be a big focus was the youth academy, and I think they see the direction that Major League Soccer is going and how beneficial it is to be able to develop players and then to be able to sell them on at, you know, obviously large profits, assuming that you're developing good players, and also in the short term it brings down costs for the first team when you're able to play homegrowns and academy kids, and then sell them on and just keep the pipeline moving the FC Dallas way.
This is a random thought that just occurred to me, but it's gonna be, I mean, that's quite a challenge considering that Montford and IMG are in the same market as whatever potential Orlando City B team would look like.
Yeah, and the fact that Orlando had partnered with Montford and they don't have a very good relationship because of that anymore. So they're directly competing with each other, and Montverde has a bone to pick with them as well. So it's going to be very hard, but because of the MLS backing that they have and the infrastructure that it comes with, I think they do have a bit of an advantage. Mm-hmm. Having said that, Montverde does has it. They do recruit. They go out and find kids from Africa and Brazil and bring them to Florida to play in that kind of environment. So I think it's going to be more Orlando trying to capitalize on the people that are already here, whereas Montverde is going to be, and IMG as well, they're going to be recruiting from all over the country.
And all over the world, really.
Yeah, all over the world, too. So something to keep in mind for the future. But I think we spent enough time in Orlando City because it's almost an hour on Orlando City. We do need to talk about the Pride. There's college soccer and the rest of MLS and World Soccer to get through. So how about those Pride players? 1-0 loss at home to Chicago to end the season. The season is over, and Becky Burleigh is not coming back as the head coach. She is dropping the interim tag and saying goodbye to the Pride.
Yeah, I mean,
is she saying goodbye or the Pride
saying
goodbye?
She is. She took herself out of the running.
Did she take herself out of the running?
She did.
Yeah, she took herself out of the running.
I mean, the Pride's performance took herself out of the running. But I do think if there was someone who, at when it was first announced, that looked like a slam dunk, Becky Burleigh was definitely the person that looked like a sure thing. I mean, even here in Florida, she's got a history of being a coach that can bring results. And they were in a prime spot to start out with. It sucks because, like, you're changing coaches midseason. You're coming in. You don't have all of your players right away to sort of get a routine started and really sort of get your, you know, whatever kind of identity you're trying to establish. Is you're not really going to have time to make that. So it's a tough position to come into, but they were making it work for a while. And then the end of September rolls around and the wheels just completely fall off. I think that's really, I mean, you can't lose 5 games in a row.
And that was right. That was one of the things that Becky said when I can't remember if it was me or Julia, but we asked her about, you know, why she took herself out of the running, and she said, and I quote, "In the end, the most difficult part for me to wrap my mind around was the lack of results for us. But if you take that away, I think the experience is one that I really enjoyed, and I'm definitely going to continue to watch the Pride from maybe a bit of a different angle now." She also went on to say, "Part of the reason for me not to stay on is because I think with the new ownership, new attitude, new outlook, and I think they need to find someone that is a little bit longer term perspective. That was never going to be me. And I think it will really be best for the organization to start building for the future."
I think that makes sense. I mean, given where she's at in her career, after such a long career,
she just retired.
It would have been hard to see, even when she was brought in, it was kind of hard to see her being a long term piece. And she makes a good point. Given all that we had kind of knew when the Pride did those press conferences, is they definitely, especially with the Wilfs now, they want to build long term sustainable success with the Pride. And preferably, that means having a coach that's going to be there for that project to play out.
Yeah, I mean, she is 54 years old and she did just retire like months before.
I mean, and when you think about college, like that's a 24/7 job, and not just playing but then recruiting and trying to constantly find the next crop of players, you know, whereas when you're a professional soccer coach, you know that you're at the office a lot, but you can delegate a lot of those tasks to other people.
I mean, she retired especially in April, like GMs and whatnot. Joined the Pride in July. So,
yeah.
That
and she said something about teaching. I guess she teaches at UF too.
Yes, she does teach at UF. Wow. Yeah. Too many U's and too many F's in this state.
Too many L's to
Ouch.
Finish out her tenure there.
Damn.
All right. Some news that has come out of the Pride organization today, being Monday. The Pride have transferred and loaned two of their players to Canberra United in Australia. So Ali Heron, who I don't think actually played a game this season, has been transferred to Canberra, whereas Chelsea Washington, who did come off the bench, has been loaned to Canberra. And with that loan, they also picked up her 2022 club option. So she will be back with the team next year at the very least.
Allie played 12 minutes against the Dash.
Ah, okay. Well, that is
she had
probably
one
why she's not coming back.
Yeah, she had one appearance all year. It was a
12 minute substitute.
Late substitution against the Dash in June.
Understandably so. Meanwhile, on the other side with Chelsea Washington, shout out Bowling Green State, where she was a graduate from. Shout out Brent Petkus as well, RIP. 30th overall pick in the 2020 NWSL draft.
He's not dead. He's just captured by ISIS.
We always RIP people that aren't on the show with us.
Oh, right. I forgot we do that here.
She did appear 10 times, had an assist in those 10 games in the 2021 campaign. But definitely a player that you can look at as depth for the future. So good to get her some more experience heading into the 2022 NWSL season. So she will join the team on April 3rd, 2022. After her loan concludes. All right, final thoughts on the Orlando Pride season. Give me a one-word summation to the Orlando Pride 2021 season. Gavin.
Poop.
Poop. Okay. Brad.
Tumultuous.
Tumultuous. I like tumultuous. I think that tumultuous has been used a number of times by different players throughout the year. I think actually... I want to say Toni Pressley said it in her press conference to end the year. But yeah, it has been very tumultuous. You go from Mark Skinner, who left the team abruptly, to Becky Burleigh, who tried her best to get them to the playoffs, but could not at the end of the day. And now they head into an offseason where they are without a coach, but they do have a GM. And so now it is up to the GM to put his stamp on the situation. Ian Fleming is getting a chance to hire his own coach, and I think that's probably very good. I think that we've seen from Orlando City's history that if the GM and the head coach work together well, they get results. And so if they're both on the same page, they will do well. And hopefully Ian Fleming can find that person that will work well with him. And we'll get results to the Pride. There's also a question of who's actually going to be coming back for the Pride, but we'll save that for the actual like off-season episode for both teams. Mm-hmm. On to college soccer, UCF men's and women's soccer. UCF men's soccer, we'll start with them. I don't know what the heck's gone on the last couple games, but they've conceded 9 goals in their last 2 games. And have lost both. They were in a position to host the conference tournament just a week ago, and they are now 6-3 in conference, with the potential of being the last seed to make it, depending on how they finish out on Friday, with they play the best team in the conference, Tulsa, at Tulsa. They just lost 5-0 on senior day to SMU at home, which, God, that was a hard game to call. It was just bad. Like, I talked to Scott Calabrese, the head coach of UCF, after the game, and he's just like, we did not show up. Nobody showed up for this team. And only when we went down a man did they actually start looking like they wanted to try, which shouldn't be the case. But it was. And now they are in a bit of limbo, where they could end up being the worst seed in the conference, or they could end up being the second seed in the conference. There's just really there's a lot in between right now.
Begs the question, has Scott Calabrese lost this locker room?
No, I think the biggest thing is that their starting center backs are out.
Hearing rumblings that...
That rumbling is in your stomach because you're hungry.
It's true. It is 6 o'clock as we record this.
So, last game, Friday, November 5th on ESPN Plus at Tulsa. 8 o'clock kickoff. On the women's side of things, their season is over. They did make the conference tournament with a 3-4-1 record. They finished out the year at home on senior day with a 5-0 win versus Temple, and then proceeded to lose at Cincinnati 3-1. They started the conference tournament on Sunday at 1 o'clock against Memphis in Memphis and lost to Memphis 2-0. And that's it. Their season is over. It was a very back-and-forth season where they had great results at the beginning of the season. They beat UF, they beat Texas, they beat Miami. And then once conference started, they just could not get results. They lost to Memphis, they lost to South Florida, they lost to Cincinnati. It was just very weird. very weird conference schedule for them and very uncharacteristic of them as well. So hopefully next year, with Tiffany Roberts Ahadek in charge, they will be better. And I know many people may say, oh, well, what about Tiffany Roberts Ahadek for the Pride job? I would like to remind folks that she did take a extension to stay with UCF soccer program through 2027.
But as we all know, coaches will take extensions and never go anywhere else, right?
Hmm.
That's never happened before.
Hmm. This is true. Although, sorry, it's 2025. I would like to also say that with Tiffany, having talked to her a multitude of times over the last year, it doesn't seem like she wants to go anywhere. And I've asked her about it. I've asked her point blank, do you want to go to NWSL? And she's like, I'm truly happy here. My kids are happy here. And no reason for me to continue on. And like, at some point, she does want to coach NWSL.
Well, there you go.
She thinks it would be a very fun opportunity, but I think
that's the real answer. Was that?
Because it has to be. She said it has to be the right opportunity.
While you're, well, I mean, hey, what better opportunity than the town you're already in? I mean, that's the answer you're going to give when you're employed by someone and you don't want to upset, you know.
Yes and no. I think Tiff is very open with a lot of stuff with that. You know, if she was talking while it was like being recorded or something, then. I don't know.
Well,
maybe
I mean,
she didn't want to put that on record. I don't know.
It's a heady play by her. You're a journalist. Nothing is ever off the record. So, you know, my hat's off to her. Game recognized game.
Fair enough. All right. Well, that's all the updates on UCF soccer. On the other side of things, Rollins soccer, their season is coming to an end as well. Rollins men, they have one last game. Tuesday, November 2nd, which by the time the show comes out will be the day it's being played. They're playing at Fort Lauderdale. They're a 4-4-1 record in conference. They look to lock up a spot in the conference tournament. On the women's side of things,
Miami.
On the women's side of things, 4-1-3 in conference. They have two more games left. A November 2nd game for senior, or sorry, not senior night. A November 2nd game in Winter Park for Nova Southeastern, and then at home on November 5th for Senior Day. And that's a Friday game that was a makeup game from earlier in the season that was canceled due to weather. That will be Senior Day, and that is this coming Friday. And then the conference tournaments start for all of them. So we will watch with great interest to see what they end up doing as the season rolls on. And now let us wrap up everything that's been happening in the world of soccer. We're going to just go through this pretty quickly. The FC Cincinnati, worst team in three consecutive years in MLS play. The wooden spoon has been passed from FC Cincinnati to FC Cincinnati. And there is no comparison. They are also one of the worst teams when it comes to consecutive losses. They have the most consecutive losses in MLS history. They are close to breaking their own record of most goals conceded in MLS history. And, God.
Do they have the most consecutive losses in MLS history?
They do. I believe either they're one away.
I think they're one away with the Metro Stars.
They've lost 11 straight, and the Metro Stars lost 12 straight. Uh-huh. So they could tie it if they lose to Atlanta for the final game of the season, which is
entirely possible.
I'd say about 90% possible.
Atlanta suddenly looks like a competent team again.
Mm-hmm. Just a smidge. But also, they did draw to Toronto, who's not good.
You know,
they gave Dom Dwyer his first assist of the season.
You know, look. It happens.
It does. It does. Realistically, it's possible that Atlanta needs to win that game to make the playoffs.
Man City lost to Crystal Palace this week, too. So, I mean,
this is true. Crazy things can happen. NWSL stuff. Kansas City, WOSO, have renamed themselves to the Kansas City Current. Thoughts?
Sure.
Yeah, that's pretty much my thoughts exactly. The logo's kind of cool. The logo's actually kind of bland.
I think the logo's pretty boring.
Yeah, it is. I don't know why.
Is it current like a river current, or like current like electricity, or like their current?
I think
like...
it has something to do with electricity.
Okay.
So the idea behind the color scheme was they're doing teal, Heartland red, and Storm blue.
I like the color scheme. I'm big on the color scheme. It's
the
name and the logo that are.
Yeah, the crest features a river current on that goes through the logo. So the three rivers is a river current, which is why they're called the Current. It also has two stars, which represent Kansas City and Missouri, but also kind of represent the two championships that Kansas City won back when they were the old Kansas City team.
Which, I mean, yeah, I mean, you can claim them again. That's fine.
FCKC was a team that played in Kansas City. It's not the same team. It's weird because the way things worked was that FCKC moved to Utah. Championships transferred to Utah, and then Utah folded. So technically, this is a brand new team, but they're also basically saying, "Hey, no, but we actually did win two championships. We're just kind of doing a fun little way of honoring that."
I don't have a problem with it.
No, I don't have a problem with it either. It's just very interesting the way they've done it. Yeah. Is all.
I mean, other than that, like everything that they've done up to this point has been fantastic. I mean, they've got a new facility in their building, what is believed to be the first women's specific soccer stadium in the country. So, like, shout out to them for that. Like, they've done awesome things to this point.
They have. And I'm excited to see what they do for the future.
The one complaint I do have, though, is that they just basically up and ripped off the Seattle Kraken's color scheme.
No, but it's different. It's different. Different colors. Because listen, it may be the same color scheme by the naked eye, but the color names are different.
I mean, I'm sure the Pantone numbers are different, but like...
The name specifically. Heartland Red and Storm Blue.
But I mean, even the Kraken's logo has red, teal, and white in it.
And blue, yeah.
So.
Yeah, there's a bit of a comparison, but also, like, their original logo, like the Kansas City NWSL placeholder logo, was kind of similar.
Yeah, but the Kraken's is way cooler, too. So.
This is true. I mean, the Current is just a river. Kraken is like a mythical beast.
Well, yeah. Where does the Kraken live? Where there's a current. So
is there a current in like
oceans?
The ocean?
Yeah, that's what the Gulf Stream is.
Never mind. Ignore me. Moving on. Federico Higuain has retired.
Ninth grade science.
We've moved on. Federico Higuain has retired.
Speaking of ninth grade science.
Federico Higuain spent a number of years in the Columbus Crew organization before.
I don't know the correlation, but it fits.
There's not. Moving on. 37-year-old Federico Higuain has played for the Columbus Crew, DC United, and Inter Miami throughout his tenure here in MLS. And he's played almost 200 games for the Crew, 10 games for DC, and 28 games for Inter Miami, where he played with his brother Gonzalo. Okay, who will, I believe, remain in the club. But yeah, that's it for Federico.
So long, farewell. Best of luck.
Yeah. 106 goals in his career. But arguably he was the best of his tenure playing-wise with Columbus from 2012 to 2019.
I don't think that's arguable. I think that's pretty well established.
Yeah, I would say so. All right. You know, interestingly enough, he also played for Besiktas back in the day.
Uh-huh.
And speaking of Besiktas,
play for them.
Yeah, Kyle Larin is being linked to Everton, Gavin.
We love it.
Do you, though?
We need a number nine of respect at Everton.
Ah! A number nine of respect. Well, Kyle Aaron is scoring goals for Besiktas. He is doing incredibly well and is definitely a hot commodity. West Ham has also put their name in the ring to try and court the Canadian striker, who has officially scored 27 goals in 62 games with Besiktas. Of course, Orlando City, he scored 43 in 87.
There's not the, I'm just finding out that he's not the only Canadian player to play for Besiktas.
Yeah, Atiba Hutchinson.
Yeah.
He's a captain. He's been there for years.
Yeah. 2013.
He's old, though.
Yeah, he is very old.
I think he's 38, I want to say.
Yeah, 38. Batman, also playing for Besiktas on loan.
Oh, Batshuayi?
Yeah.
Yeah, how about that?
Who else plays for them?
Alex Teixeira, Brazilian.
Yeah.
Nkudu from France. I don't know. Oh, and Marilyn Pjanic.
That, actually, okay. Yeah, I'll go with that.
Yeah, he's on loan from Barcelona.
He had a nice Europe spell there.
Moving on. Haji Berry, former Orlando City draft pick and UCF player, has won the Golden Boot for USL. He tied the record for most goals in a season and has had an incredibly resurgent year. It's always fun to see Haji doing well. And just a reminder, Orlando City still holds his MLS rights. Never know what'll happen.
Yeah, I think I do.
All right, last thing from MLS and World Soccer News, the Whitecaps FC shit show.
Oh boy.
Yeah, so many many months ago there was a whole thing with the Vancouver Whitecaps where there was a scandal within the women's team that they had in 2010 and 2011. This has come about multiple times and has just really hit home over the last month or so, where basically Mallory Enoch told the Guardian newspaper that Hubert Busby Jr. solicited sex from her, and he was a former coach, by the way, along with other inappropriate advances when the pair were both members of the Whitecaps women's team between 2010 and 2011. Now, because of all of this, multiple Whitecaps executives are on administrative leave after the scandal was basically brushed under the rug and the entire team knew about it. So now the MLS PR program has basically stepped in and said they will be engaging in an independent counsel to oversee a thorough investigation into how the Vancouver Whitecaps organization handled the allegations of misconduct brought in by 2011. So, not great.
Yeah, no, that's awful, and everyone there should be held accountable for their actions or inactions.
Yes, probably inactions more. So, but well, with that, I think we'll move on to the final part of our show. God, we've been recording for a while. Let's do weird news and red cards / playing advantage. Anyone got some good weird news for today?
I do.
I was looking, but I couldn't find anyone.
I've got two really. So I'll read both and have it as a make good for Gavin. One is pretty harmless, and I'll go with that one first. Influencers in Shanghai are posing in front of Costco pretending they're in LA. Chinese netizens are cashing in on the nostalgia for international travel by posing in front of China's only Costco stores if they're in sunny Los Angeles. Basically, it's a whole thing of Chinese influencers just taking pictures sitting inside of shopping carts or like posing in front of like the parking lot there in front of the Costco sign, pretending they're in LA, which is a fun way to, I guess, pretend that you're in the U.S. Look, I'm evangelical of Costco, so if Chinese influencers want to be like, hey, Costco's great, then hey, I'm right there with them.
All right.
The other news story I have, Squid Game cryptocurrency scammers make off with $2.1 million.
Oh, boy.
The anonymous hucksters behind a Squid Game cryptocurrency scam pulled the rug on the project, making off with $2.1 million. It was widely reported through a few different outlets like BBC, Yahoo News, Business Insider, Fortune, and CNBC. About how this cryptocurrency had soared by 83,000% in just a few days. So not really doing much of due diligence in reporting on a scam cryptocurrency basically resulted in these guys pulling $2.1 million in fraud. So that's fun.
It's almost like nobody really understands cryptocurrency and everyone's getting easily duped by it, and yet it's taking over the financial world.
Yeah. Gizmodo widely reported that it was probably a scam early on because you could only buy the crypto. You couldn't sell it. Their Twitter account made it impossible for anyone to reply to their posts, and their Telegram channel didn't allow them comments from outsiders. So,
yeah. Just saying. I mean, at that point, you're asking for it.
Yeah, you're kind of stupid.
I don't normally like to victim shame, victim blame. You know, either one. But yeah, no, kind of get what you're asking for there.
All right, I'll throw out two stories of weird news for you. A man was shot at a Whataburger while showing off a gun. And you'll be surprised to know this did not happen in Florida.
Texas.
This is actually in Texas.
Yep.
3 a.m., a victim who was showing off a gun to a woman in the drive-thru of the restaurant accidentally... the woman was handling the gun when it went off and hit the man in the arm. So, just dumb people doing dumb things at Whataburger, as you do. Just as you do. And then this one you'll enjoy. Facebook rebranded to a new name called Meta. Do you guys happen to know what Meta means in Hebrew?
Isn't that what Ron Artest changed his name to?
No. Meta in Hebrew means dead. So...
it's been dead to me for like 2 years. So.
Yeah, no, Facebook basically just rebranded to dead, which that is actually probably a good thing. Facebook is dead.
Ironically,
now.
It'll be dead when its aging customer base is dead.
To end the show, finally, who has a red card or who wants to play Advantage today?
I'm playing Advantage to the 76ers City Edition jerseys. A lot of NBA teams, I think all of the NBA teams, all 32 teams announced or showed off their city jerseys for the upcoming season. And the Sixers knocked it out of the fucking park, guys.
I do like the Magic, so I'll give a little play advantage to that, too.
The Magic, the nice thing I like about the Magic is the fact that they went with the old logo on the front.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Sixers kind of did something similar to that. It harkens back to the old Spectrum Arena. It's got like the old logo marks from there, and it has on the panels there, there's a red, orange, green, and blue panel. And if you're from Philadelphia, that basically tells you 4 for 4 there. That's the Phillies, Flyers, Eagles, and Sixers. Of course, the Sixers and Flyers formerly played at the Spectrum until about 94, when the Wells Fargo Arena was built, and the Phillies and Eagles, of course, playing at Veterans Stadium for a long time. So it's just cool to see like a look based on like the 70s Sixers the 76ers be brought back for this year's City Edition jerseys when all their other ones so far have been hot doo-doo, except for the one year that they did like a Rocky theme, and that was kind of cool. But other than that, they've been traditionally going with like this off-white sort of Declaration of Independence look, and that hasn't been great. So to see them sort of switch it up this year, I'm for it. It's good.
I've got a couple red cards. One of them is my everyday red card to Joe Manchin. The next one goes to where did my second one go to here?
I'm sharing a picture of the Sixers jerseys on the Discord now.
I have to open the link. That is actually pretty good. I like that a lot.
My play on, as I forget my second red card, my play on goes to the What We Do in the Shadows finale.
Oh, that's good.
The season came together pretty well. They left off on some pretty big cliffhangers there, and I'm excited to see where that picks up in season 4. I won't delve into details, obviously. You know, the three of us are I know we watch it, but for those at home,
I have not watched this new season yet, so.
Ah.
Yeah.
Well, I won't spoil it for you or anyone else.
Thank you.
I did get a lot of enjoyment out of this current season.
And I'm sure I will once I actually sit down to watch it. Yeah. I'm going to go ahead and play a red card here, straight red to USL. Mm. A couple weeks ago, I called a game with Miami and Pittsburgh where there was an egregious own goal that was scored by Miami. And for some reason, the referee misinterpreted the rule and gave a corner rather than giving a goal. So the game actually ended 0-0, which, again, the Inspector Brad special, if you have listened to this show for the last couple of years, 0-0 result, everyone goes home mad, which... More Pittsburgh than Miami probably went home mad with that result.
Yeah, couple so not days, a true Inspector Brad special.
Yeah. Fair, close enough, though. Close enough to the point where somebody was mad. Now, a couple days later, USL came back and said, you know what? The ref screwed up. We're going to actually take this game and continue it from that moment on with Pittsburgh up 1-0. That's all well and good, and I'm sure, you know, most people would say, wow, that's setting quite a precedence here, you know, that they're actually saying, hey, this they screwed up, the ref screwed up, and now they're actually going back to fix the problem. Here's the issue. Paul Dalglish, son of former legend Kenny Dalglish from the old Premier League days, he wrote an open letter saying, we tried to actually forfeit the game because we just don't care to play it. You're making us play a midweek game where we don't have anyone healthy and we just don't care to play anymore. And the USL said, no, you're playing this. Sorry. And at that point, it's like, why are you making Pittsburgh fly all the way back down to Miami for a midweek game to play 29 minutes and then have to go back and play their final game of the season just a couple days later? And Miami was fully ready to accept a loss. They're like, we'll just take the loss. Just don't make us play. But they did. And at that point, it's just like, come on, guys. Don't make it more difficult.
Which is a lesson I think we can all take to heart. Come on,
yeah,
guys.
I mean, what's to stop Pittsburgh from just not showing up?
Well, they were up 1-0, so if they didn't show up, they would have actually not gotten. They would have forfeited.
I mean, if I played for Pittsburgh, I'd take the trip to Miami because maybe Miami just doesn't show up for the match, but I get a trip to Miami out of it.
Yeah, but it's a midweek trip to play like 30 minutes.
Who's to say that they actually play?
I mean, they did. At the end of it, they did. And then they had to go back and play Hartford, where it was a 0-0 draw, and everyone went home mad.
Oh. See? Yeah, that sucks.
Mm-hmm. And now they get to play the Birmingham Legion, who were one of the best teams in the Eastern Conference. They were just 1 point behind Louisville for the best team in the Eastern Conference. Actually, third best team, technically. Because Tampa Bay was actually the best team in the entire USL.
Hey, Ant Pulis has got those guys playing well.
What?
Huh?
Ant Pulis is the assistant coach for Miami.
I mean, James O'Connor's got those guys in Louisville playing pretty well.
James O'Connor is not the coach of Louisville City.
What year
He's
is
the
it?
GM. It's 2021. James O'Connor is the GM of the NWSL team in Louisville.
He's got them playing well in Louisville. My point still stands.
He's there physically in spirit to get them playing well. He's just not doing anything on the coaching staff to do so.
He's there in the office every day.
He is there in the organization, that is for sure. Well, anyways, on that note, I think we should just go ahead and end the show because we've gone an hour and a half.
I know a thing or two about USL. He's there. He's you know, helping out.
He has been there. He's been there and done that.
In Louisville.
Anyways, yes, this is true, and he's still there. As we continue this this circle around and around, and as Korg from Thor would say, it's more like a freaky circle. I think we should end the show here, call it a day. And
nothing matters. Nothing has any consequence.
Yes, Loki, no consequences. Nothing matters. Well, let's go ahead and end it. For Brad Newton, for Gavin Ewbank, I'm Austin David. Thanks for tuning into another edition of the Orlando Soccer Show. We'll be back potentially to wrap up the entire 2021 season. Who knows what'll happen next week, but we can't wait to talk about it. That's for sure.
Oh, boy.
So, yep. We'll see you later.
Bye-bye.
You're dirty brown water trash, and you're always going to be dirty brown. Water trash!